Okay, this will be your lab class 2. In this particular lab, what you will be taught is clean room etiquettes. When you are in clean room, what to do and what not to do. Okay. See, there are several equipment in the clean room class, let us say class 1000 or class 100, which uses lot of gases. And these are harmful gases because these are used for growing silicon, also etching silicon and etching several other metals, semiconductors, insulators, right. Silicon of course is a semiconductor. So, we not only use the gas, which also we also use chemicals. So, if you do not follow the protocol, it is extremely harmful or dangerous for the clean room user, and that is why clean room etiquettes are extremely important. When to throw the gloves, where to throw the gloves, when you start the process, what precautions you need to take, so on and so forth. So, we will be talking about this particular etiquettes in this particular lab class. We will also understand different equipment such as microscope. Now, when you talk about microscope, we have a metallurgical microscope which will be looking at this particular lab class. Then we will also look at the incubator. So, what exactly incubator is, and what kind of incubators are there. In this particular lab, we will focus on the incubator that is used for cells as well as bacteria. See, incubator will be similar to, or equipment which is similar to our body environment. It will have 95% relative humidity, it will have 5% carbon dioxide, and the temperature is around 37 degrees centigrade. This incubator environment is used for cells, so that cells are alive. Then when you talk about cells, it can be cancer cells, it can be other body parts, cells from other body parts or tissues, and we also talk about bacteria, right. Because one of the techniques that we will be looking at in this particular course is to develop microfluidic chip for capturing bacteria from a biological sample. We will also talk about cells and tissues, and that is why if you want to keep the tissue or cells alive, you have to use a media, and this entire structure or the in vitro platform should be kept in the incubator, which will have a similar environment like our body. So, we will be talking about incubator in the lab class. We will be also looking at HEPA filters. So, what are HEPA filters? HEPA filters are high energy particulate air. Teaching assistant will discuss the kind of HEPA filter. We will be showing you the clean room which is non-conventional clean room, and then we will also show you the clean room which is conventional clean room. So, what are the difference? The non-conventional clean room is clean room where you do not have the filters onto a false ceiling, but instead of have, you will have the filters that we will be looking at in the lab, which are our modules. And then the TA will tell you what is the how it can be used to filter the air within the laboratory. All right. So, this will be our lab 2. I will request my teaching assistant to now teach you about the clean room etiquettes, incubators, metallurgical microscope, and HEPA filter. Again, like always, you are free to ask us any questions, any doubts that you have through NPTEL forum, right. So, till then, you take care, have fun with the lab class, understand it thoroughly, and feel free to ask questions. Thank you.
So, now we have a visiting scholar who want to use the facility here. As you can see, he would like to use the clean room for his purpose. So, now he would enter the clean room. So, he is Professor Shivshankar from KLE Technology University, a visiting scholar here in DSE. So, now even before he enters the clean room, let's see the procedure what he follows. So, as you can see, he's picked up the shoe covers from the container there, and he stands over the carpeted area just so that you don't contaminate from the external ground. So, you ensure you stand on the carpeted area, which is generally clean compared to the surrounding environment. So, now after wearing the shoe covers, he uses the clean room. As you can see to the right side, there are laboratory safety protocols which clearly state the mandatory protocols which are to be followed even before entering the clean room. So now he takes the axis and enters the clean room. So now once he's got the axis, like you can see, he opens the clean room door. So now you see how he enters the clean room and then shuts the door. So the noise what you saw in the clean room is the air filter. On top we have an air curtain which is going to flow air at around 10 meter per second speed. So the inrush of air, the influx of air, is just to ensure that the particulate count is constrained or restricted to that area in order to reduce any sort of contamination or particulate count or dust entering inside the clean room. We have this mechanism of flowing high speed air just at the entrance of the door. Now as soon as you give your fingerprint and open the door, the sensor there detects the entrance and then the air curtain gets activated. Now that we've seen how our visiting scholar has used the gown there and he's worn. As you can see, he's having his shoe covers and the gown. And to his right side, there is a hand sanitizer. Again, why is it important to use the hand sanitizer when you are, even before you enter the clean room? In case you think there could be some sort of dust or particulates on your hand, you ensure you use this sanitizer and clean your hands just so that it does not hamper the working of your device. Also, even before you leave this laboratory, always use the sanitizer. Again, in the coming modules, you will understand how you will be doing the cell and tissue culture and you will be dealing with these sensors so that, and once you start working with them, your hands get contaminated, and just to prevent them from harming yourself and prevent you from any sort of disease, you always use the sanitizer, protect your hands, and then move out of the lab. Next, he proceeds towards the bench where we have the hairnet, face mask and the gloves. So as you can see, he picks up the face mask always ensuring that the white color thin strip comes on top and so that it fixes right above, right on top of your nose in a proper manner, so that you cannot, you need not keep on meddling with it while and then disturb, it might disturb while you work. So just that you have to follow a right procedure while you're gowning yourself. Now that we have worn the face mask, let's see how he uses the hairnet and covers the complete head just so that there is no hair, no contamination due to hair fall. So now that we have the hairnet on, let's see how the gloves are chosen and worn. So there are three sets of gloves. Considering you just do the normal works in under a workstation, like just study or characterize his devices, then he would go with the nitrile gloves of a particular size that fits him right. Assume you have a loose gloves and then you move towards your workstation, then there's always possibility that it would really not give the right tactile feedback to your, you know, hands, and then there could be slippage or any other sort of activity which you don't want to happen inside the clean room. And always it is important for you to notice while you see the video how he's using the gloves and then ensuring that the gloves sits exactly on top of the cuff sleeves of his lab coat. So in case you're moving to wet bench or any other workstation where you're dealing with HF or such harmful acids, Then what you do is, you don't remove these gloves, but just on top of these gloves, you wear the silicone gloves or the MAPA gloves, the thick gloves which are chemical resistant. So these gloves are not really chemical resistant, they're just used to protect the environment from contamination. So this was the entire gowning procedure what the visiting scholar has followed in order to use the clean room facility here in the lab. Now that we have seen how a clean room procedure has to be followed, like you've seen how the gowning procedure, the sequence of following the procedure becomes very important. Let me tell you about more about the clean room. So here when I say class 10,000 clean room, I told you initially that the particulate count is constrained, restricted to to certain numbers, and that you could study more about how the ISO standard is and how clean rooms across the country and nation and worldwide have been classified based on the ISO standards. So here we have a class 10,000 clean room, and apart from the particulate count, another important heart of the clean room is the HEPA filter. So you can see the big tower here. There are four such towers in our laboratory here. So this is the HEPA filter. HEPA stands for High Efficient Particulate Air, HEPA. So there are different types of filters, the EPA, UCLA, HEPA filters, again based on the efficiency and again depending on the type of environment and the usage. So here we have HEPA filters. The main purpose of using this is to reduce the particulate count. A controlled environment inside the clean room is maintained just because of these filters here. So it is going to maintain the temperature, the humidity levels, as well as the particulate contamination. And then there is a positive pressure module along with the four towers here. So we have two towers here and the remaining two in the biology section on this side of our lab. So this is the biology section, and as you can see, there is a tower on the other end of the biology section. So there are four such towers here, and then there is a positive pressure module on one end. So what the positive pressure module does is, it is going to pump in pressured air. So why do you need to have an environment which has slightly higher pressure compared to the atmospheric or the outside environment? So this entire room is slightly at a higher pressure compared to the outside. Just when you go beyond the door, the pressure outside is completely different. It is lower compared to this pressure here. So we maintain this pressure using these HEPA filters, and the purpose of having higher pressure inside these rooms is just to avoid influx of air. So you always know that if air always flows from a higher concentrated area to a lower pressure area. So when you maintain a higher pressure, so there is clean air which would go out, but then the contaminated air or the unfiltered air which is outside would not infiltrate into this environment. And that's why we call this as a controlled environment, and hence we have the HVAC system. As you can see, we had an air curtain just at the beginning at the entrance, just to reduce the particulate contaminants which could be affecting the environment inside. So how these HEPA filters work is, 50% of the atmospheric air is taken in, and 50% of the air which is inside, the clean air, is always recirculated within these filters. So when you're talking about recirculation, what happens is, assume I'm going to maintain this clean room at perfectly clean levels. So the amount of energy that the entire HVAC system takes, the load on the system, reduces provided you put your efforts in maintaining the clean room by following these procedures, reducing the particulate count. So by following these procedures, you could reduce the load on the HVAC system. Otherwise, what happens is, provided you want the particulate count to be low, however, you do not follow any of these guidelines, the amount of load what the system takes is higher. So they have a lifetime, and this each of the system have their own lifetime, and efficiency frequently have to be checked. They have to be checked annually for their pressure levels. So there's no point in them if they do not function properly, and if the room is not maintained at positive pressure, then there's no point in us having a controlled environment system. There could be possibility of having the malfunctioning of your devices or having not maintaining the class the clean room for its purpose. So in order to save your devices for a better efficiency, for a better lifetime of these filters, you always do your best to maintain the clean room for the given standards. And this was a brief introduction about how we work in a class 10,000 clean room, how the governing procedure is to be followed. Once we have all the basic steps in hand, then we proceed in our future modules, in our next coming modules, what are the different equipments that are available in the facility here, why are those equipments used, where have they been procured from, how they can be handled, and what characterization can be done using the tools and its designated places. It will be briefed in our future lectures. So this was about the governing procedure in a clean room. Thank you.